This is the lecture for Friday, April 10th. We will be continuing our discussion of the quark gluon plasma and the heavy ion program at the Large Hadron Collider. So here's a picture of the ATLAS detector, and here's a picture of the CMS detector. Right, so the ATLAS and CMS detectors were mainly designed for high-energy particle physics, the discovery of the Higgs and properties of the Higgs particles, decays, and physics like that. But they can also be used for heavy ion collisions. Now, ELISE is pictured here, and ELISE is designed specifically for heavy ion collisions. So remember, when the LHC program turned on, they were doing collisions for lead-lead of about 2.76 TeV. In 2013, they went to proton-lead at about 5.02 TeV, tera-electron volts, per nucleon-nucleon collision. And then in 2015, so that's not on the slide here, but in 2015, they did lead with lead at nucleon-nucleon energies of 5.02 TeV. Here is a picture of the ELISE experiment. I'll magnify it a little bit more. So you can see there's a lot of stuff going on here. Here's a zoom in of the silicon tracking system where they try to see the various tracks and the secondary vertices that come off from unstable particles. You try to reconstruct the decays that you get. Actually, we'll talk about this in a moment, and you can see the scale of things here is person. So you have then the collision between the two nuclei. They come in, they bang here, and you're looking at things more or less centered around the perpendicular direction. So you're not looking at things very coming along the beam direction, because there's just too much stuff flying out in the forwards and the backwards directions. So here are some of the tracks you see in the ELISE data. Okay. It's an actual event reconstructed. And so with these tracks, you try to figure out the underlying physics that you see. Now here's a sense of the geometry of the system. So now in red is the LHC numbers, in red is the Rick numbers, in green is the LHC numbers. Right, so because these are relativistic collisions, these nuclei are moving at close to the speed of light, and so you get a lot of Lorentz contraction. Right, so you get this gamma factor of 100 for Rick. So in other words, if you had a nucleus like this, it's pancake shape, it's contracted by a factor of 100. And at the LHC, it's contracted by a factor of about 1,350. And so that's what you can see here. These nuclei are really quite compact in the laboratory frame. So the radius, let's say, of the lead nucleus is about 14 Fermi. The width here would be 14 Fermi if it was stationary, but because it's moving near the speed of light, it's contracted. Factor 14 divided by either 100, or for the LHC 1,350. Okay. So here is, well, I'm not showing you the simulations, but you can find online some of these simulations where you have these two pancakes come together. And what happens is you just light up the system, and all kinds of stuff comes flying out. First form the quark gluon plasma. That's what's shown here. You first form your quark gluon plasma. Okay, and this is supposed to represent physics in the early universe. And now, eventually, it comes into equilibrium, and you're in the quark gluon plasma, and then it cools down, starts expanding out, and you get hadronization. And that's when you start getting this, it's called the hadron phase, gas phase, where you have pions, kaons, protons, neutrons interacting with each other. But at some point, the system expands more and more, so that these hadrons stop interacting with each other, and so that's when you get what's called the kinetic freeze-out phase. Okay, so you just have this these free-streaming particles that you get out, and that's eventually when you detect the particles, and you try to figure out what was going on. Okay, so there's these different stages. You have the pre-equilibrium dynamics before it's really in equilibrium. Eventually, it equilibrates. Okay, but then you have this viscous hydrodynamics phase. So we'll talk about this quite a bit more next time. But you have hydrodynamics where it acts like a fluid, and there's some viscosity associated with it. But then eventually it changes over to a hadron gas. And then you just have these decoupled particles that are free streaming away from each other. So what are the big picture questions we'd like to answer? We want to know, what are the states of matter that exist at high temperature and density? And then, can we explore the phase structure of gauge theory, like quantum chromodynamics, fundamental gauge theory? And can we use this to understand other gauge theories? For example, gravity. Now, here's the phase diagram of strongly interacting matter. So let's take a look at this a little bit more carefully. Is the phase diagram of quantum chromodynamics, for example, featureless above the critical temperature? And what are the constituents in this case? Are there quasi-particles, exotic states? And is there really a critical point? Okay. So here is the phase diagram. Here's the baryon density, meaning how many nucleons we have per cubic volume, per unit volume. And this is the density of the iron nucleus. Okay, and so here is a picture of the hadronic gas. So this is this is density, this is the vertical axis is the temperature. So here is about 170 MeV. That's believed to be about the critical point in temperature, the critical temperature. And below this critical temperature, we have, if we're not at too high densities, we have this hadron gas. Okay, over here we have a nuclear liquid behavior, but that's at very, very low temperatures relative to this critical temperature. Now, above this critical temperature, you have this quark-gluon plasma. Okay, now, there is believed to be what's called the critical endpoint, where you can actually go around the critical endpoint, and you actually don't go through a phase transition. It's only when you cross this first order, what is called the first order phase transition line, that you actually see this transition as a discontinuous transition. If you go around this critical point, this is what's called a crossover transition, where you smoothly connect the two. And so there's a lot of effort to try to figure out where this critical endpoint is. So there are lots of things that people would like to know about the quark-gluon plasma here. One is, what are the so-called transport properties? Things like, how does sound attenuate, through the medium? If you actually make a sound signal in the quark-gluon plasma, how quickly does that die away as a function of distance? What is the viscosity of the system? How syrupy is it if you try to stir it up? How much resistance does it give to stirring? And you can measure this as a ratio of the viscosity to entropy. We'll talk about that next time. That will be a big topic for next time. There's also questions about the formation time of this quark-gluon plasma in the heavy ion collision. And what is the equation of state, and what are the excited modes that you can excite when you have these non-equilibrium systems? And you might also be interested whether there are new phenomena, like new states of matter, that you might be able to explore. However, this is really not the regime of the heavy ion collisions. That's more at lower temperatures, at higher densities, that there might be some exotic phases, like what's called a color superconductor, or or these more exotic things, like what's called a color flavor locked phase, which this is just a hypothetical possibility here. What this color flavor locked phase means, it's related to color superconductor, but it's using the fact that there are three light quarks. There are up, down, and strange, and there happen to be three colors. And so there's this proposition that there's some sort of pairing or alignment of these three colors with these three flavors. That's what's called the color flavor locked phase. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the relativistic dynamics here. So the energy, the relativistic energy, right, E squared is P squared plus M squared, where I'm using units where the speed of light C is equal to 1. So we can break apart the energy in terms of the kinetic energy and the mass, right, because I'm taking C to be equal to 1. Or you can take E to be equal to the gamma factor times the mass. So that's how gamma is defined. So gamma is 1 over the square root of 1 minus beta squared, where beta is the velocity over the speed of light, or that's just the same as the momentum over the energy. So if I now have two different Lorentz frames, I have, let's say, x, y, z here, and then I have x prime, y prime, z prime, and let's say there's a relative velocity of v, and beta is v over c. Then if I do a transformation of the energy, it transforms like this. E prime is gamma times E plus beta pz. So this, by the way, the relative velocity is in the z direction here. Okay. For pz prime, that's gamma times pz plus beta times E. So you can actually write this also in terms of these hyperbolic angles. So I don't know, perhaps you've seen this. There's a thing called the rapidity. So if you haven't seen this before, I'll try to explain it. So let's call phi the rapidity angle. And so then I can write down this whole transformation property that E prime is equal to something times E plus something times PZ. So this can be written as the hyperbolic cosine of phi times E, this Lorentz transformation, times the hyperbolic sine of phi times PZ. And then I can write PZ prime as the hyperbolic cosine of phi times PZ plus the hyperbolic sine of phi times E. All right? So then if I make the connection with these gammas and betas here, the beta is going to be the hyperbolic tangent of phi, and the gamma is going to be the hyperbolic cosine of phi. Okay, now, I can also, let's say the beam direction, the beam is, you have the collision going in the z direction, right? So then the longitudinal momentum, PL, is just PZ, and the transverse momentum is just the magnitude of the momentum in the other directions, the x and the y directions. So then you can, well, this, we're not going to need this, but the transverse mass would just be the square root of pt squared, this transverse momentum squared plus mass squared. And then you can define something that's called the rapidity, which is 1/2 the logarithm of E plus PL over E minus PL. So what this rapidity is let's say you have a momentum, so let's say here's the z direction again, that's the positive z direction, and then let's say you have momentum going like this, right? Then what the rapidity is the rapidity that you need, so I'm going to call it y this time instead of calling it phi, but this y is the rapidity that you need to go into a frame to essentially catch up with this particle, so that to you in your frame it looks like the momentum is perpendicular to the z direction. So in other words, if we have this particle going with this momentum, if you move fast enough, so you're moving transversely fast enough, you only see then the motion perpendicular to z, and that corresponding boost that you need, Lorentz boost you need, or the rapidity you need to do that, is this y factor, this y here. This is the rapidity. If you solve the equations, you get y is 1/2 logarithm of e plus pl over e minus pl. Now, in this in these Hebbian collisions, it's also sometimes useful to define something called pseudorapidity. And pseudorapidity is something that is very close to the rapidity here, in the case that the energy is much larger than the mass of the particle, so that it's a very relativistic system. So, but the pseudorapidity, though, however, is a bit different, in that it depends on the angle that you make to the beam, the beam axis. Okay, so let's say that here's plus z, so here's the angle theta, and so the pseudorapidity is just minus the logarithm of the tangent of theta over 2, right? And as I said, if the energy is very large, is very relativistic, then the pseudorapidity ends up being very close to the rapidity, and it's an easier formula because it only depends on the angle here. So the way it works is that if your beam, if your angle theta is equal to 0, then your rapidity actually goes to infinity. Okay. Eta goes to infinity, the pseudorapidity, pseudorapidity goes to infinity. Now, if the angle is 90 degrees, then the pseudorapidity eta is going to be equal to 0. Okay, and if you go in the opposite direction, it's going to be, it's going to go to minus infinity this way. Okay. All right, so that's so sometimes they'll say in these Hebbian collisions that mid rapidity, that just means perpendicular to the beam direction. Okay, so now you got a whole bunch of particles, and you can try to then identify these particles. You can use various techniques. So here is. ITS stands for what's called the inner tracking system. That's the innermost layer of the Alise detector, where they do the silicon tracking. Okay, so you can measure the energy loss per unit length, dE, dx, and you can also measure the amount of momentum that you have. Okay, and from this two-dimensional plot, you can track out when you have an electron, when you have a pion, when you have, this is a kaon here, and when you have a proton. You can also do this in the time projection chamber, and that's where you are more sensitive in this region here. Okay. Now, then you can also do the time of flight measurements, and you can also identify particles from time of flight. All right, that's another technique. And then you can also, this is looking at the Cherenkov angle. So this is the ring Cherenkov detector, where you actually see the halo that you get from the Cherenkov light, and from that you can determine again what the particles are from this Cherenkov angle. Okay, so you can make these particle identifications. You can do it for different types of collisions. So you can identify whether you have a central collision where you have the two lead nuclei could be essentially hitting straight on head on, or they could be sort of glancing where they're not hitting straight on. So these are central collisions, and these are what are called peripheral collisions. And so you can see here, this is the what's called the multiplicity, and here the number of stuff that particles you see per pt is the transverse momentum, and y we just saw was the rapidity. Okay, so here's a plot of the multiplicity, versus transverse momentum, and this is for the pions, how many pions you see. This is for the protons, and you can also, here's a nice plot of the resolution you need for various unstable particles. So the kaons will decay into, well, we just learned this, right, a few lectures ago. The K short can decay into two pions. The lambda can decay into proton pi. These are all weak decays, by the way. And the C, the cascade, can decay into lambda pi. And so you have to be able to resolve then these little tracks where the unstable particle lives, and you can resolve the various tracks that you see here. Okay. So you have, for example, the C can decay into pi minus and a lambda, okay? And then the lambda will decay into proton and pi minus. So you will like to resolve these secondary and tertiary vertices. And here's just showing you the vertex resolution that you can get in units of micrometers for various transverse momenta for various types of collisions. And here's now then the number of counts you can see versus the invariant mass. You measure then of the daughter particles that you see from this decay. You end up calculating the invariant mass. Basically, you combine together the momentum and energy into a combination that's like the mass of a particle, meaning the square root of e squared minus p squared. And that will, if you plot then the counts per the invariant versus the invariant mass, you can see a nice peak here. That's telling you that you have a nice resonance peak. Okay, the same thing is done here for. So this is for the cascade particle. Okay, so you can see the cascades here, for the cascade minus and the cascade plus. Then we can also do this for the omega minus here. You can see the nice peak. All right, so now you can ask whether we see a consistent picture of the geometry, let's say, of the dynamics and the evolution of these relativistic heavy ion collisions. And so here is a plot of the, again, n is a multiplicity, okay, versus pseudorapidity, normalized according to number of particles that you believe, sorry, number of participants in the collision. So here's what I mean here. You can, on this second plot here, so the number of participants for a peripheral collisions is much less. So the number of nucleons that would hit each other would be much less. But when you have a central collision, you have more participants. So we're normalizing this multiplicity with respect to the number of participants. So then the question is once you make that normalized multiplicity per pseudorapidity angle, and then you plot it versus the energy per nucleon-nucleon collision, what is that scale like? And you can see here data for the central collisions for the relativistic heavy ion collider in Brookhaven, as well as the data that you get from the LHC. So all this is LHC data way out here. This is the Rick data, and you can see it follows a curve that's something like the energy is at the 0.15 power. You can also make the measurement of the multiplicity versus the number of participants, and what you see here, so the data from the LHC is in the red circles. It bends a bit more than the data that you see from the Rick data, but they're not that different from each other. And so there's some models for exactly what's causing this, of why is there a decrease here in the multiplicities, and so sometimes they call this decrease in the outgoing states, something is called shadowing, just this reduction of this possible reaction process. Okay, you can also do something really, what I kind of find rather cool, is you can actually measure the system size using interference. So the idea is if you have identical particles like photons, is an example. In fact, this is used in astronomy, that you can determine the size of a given star by measuring the interference effects of the photons between two detectors. So the basic point is that the photons are Bose, identical Bose particles, and so what you can have is you can have, right, you might have two identical particles with two different detectors, and you can have the process where this guy goes here, this guy goes here, but you can also have the process where they're exchanged, okay? Because they're identical particles, you add the quantum amplitudes together, and so there's an enhancement process from this effect. And the same thing can be done, by the way, and that tells you something about the distance, the separation between where these particles came from. You can get some information about that from the interference pattern that you see here. Now, the same technique here, this interferometry technique, can be used to measure the system size by measuring, for example, the pions that you see in this collision. And so you can make an estimate of the system size. So these are the system size measurements for the Rick heavy ion collider, Brookhaven, and you can see what you get for ALICE at the LHC. So it's quite a bit larger in size, okay, and obviously more multiplicity as well. And then you can also measure the lifetime, so you can sort of convert the sizes into distances, because things travel at the speed of light, and then you can think of it in terms of lifetimes. Okay, so what have we learned again? But now we're looking at the particle ratios to say something about the equilibrium abundances and something about the critical temperature, okay, and make comparisons with lattice QCD experiments, lattice QCD calculations. So here is a very simple thermal model. Basically, you do a Boltzmann distribution, right? So the point is, Boltzmann distribution is that you have if you have an energy, the probability of measuring something at a given energy will be proportional to e to the minus the energy over kBT, where T is the temperature. And so you can just simply make a model like this for different particles with different masses. That's what goes in here, different mass particles for a given temperature, and you can try to compare then whether what you're seeing is corresponding with some thermal distribution, okay? And so what you see here is the ratio of abundances so here these are all ratios of things that should be about 1. It's like pi minus over pi plus, k minus over k plus, so these all come out to about 1. But then you can measure ratios of things that would have different masses, like k plus to pi plus, right? And the lines are predictions from for a temperature of about 160.5 MeV or 155 MeV. And so you can see for these different ratios, you get very good predictions just from a simple Boltzmann distribution. The same thing is shown here. I'm just blown up a little bit more so that you can see the ratios for the cases where the ratio is a little bit smaller. And you can see it still does relatively well. And so you can make contact now with these lattice QCD calculations, that the idea that we have some critical temperature of about 170 MeV, okay, and then you can try to determine the temperature of a given event, whether you're at the critical temperature or above or below the critical temperature. So we talked about this before. The idea that we have these exotic phases, right? So we have the quark gluon plasma, we have the hadron gas, and here's our critical temperature, and whether there's this critical endpoint. Now, I think I'll stop here so that we can continue next time talking about this very interesting topic about the hydrodynamics and the viscosity of these collisions. I'll talk to you next week.